I want to begin by playing you the accompaniment of an Italian song, Il Bacio, The Kiss. And I play this because this is what many people regard as a typical accompaniment, and it goes like this. And so on and so forth, ad lib. But unfortunately, so many people, when they listen to a fine song by a fine composer, take it for granted that the accompaniment to that song means no more and contributes no more than that little tidlibit I played just now. And the result is that they cut off their ears to the accompaniment altogether. Well, they miss an awful lot by doing that, because the composer of a great song uses the piano part to paint pictures. He uses the piano part to evoke a mood. And he sometimes makes his piano part reflect the very words that the singer is uttering. I want now to give you quite a lot of examples by Schubert, because Schubert was perhaps the first of the great songwriters really to make a duet between the voice and the piano. He promoted the accompaniment from a vague rumbling in the background, or a distant tinkling, to equal partnership with the voice. And you can say that all the great songwriters since Schubert's time have imitated Schubert in that one respect. They have made a duet between the voice and the piano. And an accompanist who sits down to play the accompaniment of any great song takes half the responsibility for the performance of it. Mind you, when I say the accompanist takes half the responsibility, I don't mean for a moment that the accompanist succeeds in marching off with half the fee. But we accompanists have minds above such mundane and sordid things as fees. All the same, it's a great regret to me that people, I'm convinced, do not listen properly when they listen to a song. They do not take in the piano part. But I have a much more personal reason for regretting this attitude towards the accompanist, and that is that I would like people to realize, what extremely important people we accompanists are. Of course, I know what happens. You go to a concert, and the most enchanting, elegant young lady walks on to sing. All the ladies look at her because they're interested in what she's wearing. And all the men look at her because, all the men look at her. Nobody looks at me, and I can't blame them. But, you know, sometimes the people I follow onto the platform are quite an eyeful. I mean, they occupy a lot of space. They float in, and they take their stand in the bend of the piano, and you find, on close examination sometimes, that the bend of the piano seems to be made to measure. Nobody notices the accompanist at all. And if they do happen to look at him, well, he looks so slender and so shy and so modest. The people think he's just there to do what he's told, to obey orders, to follow the singer through thick and thin. Well, there's a great deal more to it than that. In these days, there is a real partnership between the singer and accompanist. And I want to try and show you how the accompanist contributes to that partnership. I spoke just now of pictures in the piano part. And there's a well-known song of Schubert called Wohin, Whither. And this is the tune the singer sings. Now, you can't tell by listening to that tune that the singer is singing about a running stream, a little babbling brook. But when you hear the accompaniment that ripples and runs underneath that tune, you get the picture. Because here in the accompaniment is the picture. Here is the little babbling brook. and so on, it ripples and runs right through the song. By the way, the accompanist who makes a rallentando, that is to say, who slows up at the end of the song, is making a great mistake, because the little brook doesn't slow up at all. To play it like this is wrong. No, we should do what Schubert wants us to do. We should go right to the last chord without slackening the tempo, so that when I do come to that last chord, it comes so suddenly, you can really, in your imagination, feel this fluttering rhythm going on underneath. Another of Schubert's lovely songs is one called Auf dem Wasser zu singen, to be sung on the water. Here you're supposed to be in a rowboat, and in the piano part, you can really see the water lapping the side of the boat as it glides through the water. Just listen to this lovely effect that Schubert gets. These two pictures are very obvious, I know, and they could be called just watercolours of water music. But Schubert was by no means addicted to water. I want to play you now another picture from Schubert's songs, and this is a much more subtle one. This not only demands the attention of the listener to what the accompaniment is doing, it needs the listener's imagination as well, just as it needs the imagination of the player. And it's called Der Lindenbaum, the lime tree. In this song, the singer says in the first verse, how delightful it is in the cool of the summer evening to sit under the branches of the lime tree and listen to the leaves softly whispering in the summer breeze. Now, this is the tune the singer sings to us, and a lovely tune it is. Yes, it's a lovely tune, but you can't really say you can see a picture of a tree in that tune. No, the picture comes in the piano part. Now here's the introduction to this song, and I'm sure if you use your imagination, you'll be able to picture this tree, you'll be able to hear the leaves softly rustling together. There are the leaves rustling. And now the scene changes. It's winter time. And all the leaves have been swept from the branches, and you can hear the wind howling through the naked boughs of the tree. There's the wind howling. I do hope next time you hear that song, you'll take in what the accompaniment is saying. If you do, how much richer and how much more full of meaning the music will be. For the accompanist to find these pictures in his piano parts and to reveal them to his listener, it stands to reason that he must know the story, must understand every word the singer is singing. I say this advisedly because, you see, we accompanists have to play songs in almost every civilized language: French, German, Italian, Spanish, Finnish, English, and so on. And we must know what the words are about. If we don't, very grave disasters can occur. For instance, I was giving a lesson one day to a young lady who was trying to play the accompaniment of a song by Hugo Wolf. Now, Wolf, like Schubert, was an Austrian. All his songs were written to German words. And this particular song, with a very tricky accompaniment, is called Bitt ihn, O Mutter, which means Beg him, O Mother. It's a young girl in the song, and she's singing to her mother, and she says, O Mother, do beg Cupid not to molest me. O Mother, do beg the young god of love not to hurl his darts at me. Bitt ihn, O Mutter. Well, I saw this young lady clench her teeth in a most vicious snarl. She bunched her muscles together, and then she flung herself on the keyboard. Well, I'm very fond of my piano, so I stopped her very hurriedly, and I said, just a moment, you do know, of course, what Bitt ihn, O Mutter means, don't you? She said, yes, it means bite him, O Mother. Well, you can see what a distressing affair that song would be. The singer would be pulling in one direction, and the accompanist would be pulling in another. And between them, of course, the song would be pulled to pieces. And this is why it is so terribly important for the accompanist to know what's going on. And this is quite a job sometimes, when you get all sorts of languages thrown at you. Some accompanists have perhaps a slight knowledge of French and German. I, though you'd scarcely believe it, I have a smattering of English. But if the accompanist doesn't know the language of the song, he must search in a dictionary or else get some friend to come in and translate the song for him. There are many magnificent American singers, and very good friends of mine they are too. Sometimes they engage me to play for them. Yes, they do, occasionally. Often they'll bring American songs, and I nearly always get a friend to come in and translate these songs into English. I was playing some years ago for a Russian singer who sang a program consisting entirely of Russian songs set to Russian words. Well, I can get along in Russian, of course, but not well enough to cope with such poets as Tolstoy and Pushkin. So I had to get the words explained to me, and I'm sure it made a great difference to my playing. But as I say, I can get along in Russian. I can say, Da, niet, pozhelstvo, spasibo, yo vas lublu, Gospodi. And believe me, you can get anywhere on that. You can get to Siberia on that. It means, yes and no, please and thank you, I love you, heaven help me. Well, all this is by way of preambling towards my next subject, which is how the accompanist tries to make his playing reflect the singer's words. Now, very often, we have to play a strophic song. A strophic song is a song of 2, 3, 4, 5 or more verses where the singer sings the same tune and the accompanist plays the same notes in each verse. It's like a hymn tune. We sing the same tune all through the hymn. We have the same accompaniment, the same harmony. Only the words vary. Well, many a composer has written a strophic song like that. Schubert has written a song called Das Wandern, Wandering, and it has 5 verses. Now, what happens is this. The accompanist gets hold of the music, and it's all on one page, and he says to himself, Ah, I have to play this page through 5 times. Good. I can go to sleep at the beginning, and I needn't wake up till the end. But the singer is not going to say that, for he's telling the story. He's going to vary the color and the quality of his tone. He's going to vary his volume and rhythm and his phrasing according to what he's singing, according to the words. In fact, you can say that the singer is going to use his imagination. Well, the accompanist must use his imagination too. And although he's playing the same notes all the time, he should do something with his touch and with his tone to help suggest what the singer is singing about. Now, this particular song, Wandering, has, I say it with all respect to Schubert, a rather a dull sort of accompaniment. It's all set down here in the bass of the piano in this register. And it never moves any higher than that. There's nothing up on the top of the piano to give it light and sparkle and brilliance like this. No, it's all down here. Well, as there are five verses to this song, I'm going to play it through to you five times. This is how the first verse goes. In that verse, the singer said, I want to wander, I want to roam, I want to see the world. And in the second verse, he espies a little millstream, and he says, I want to be like this little millstream. It's never still, it's never satisfied until it's reached the sea. Well, I, like that little stream, will not be satisfied until I have achieved something. So as the singer sings about this little millstream, we try to make our tone liquid and bubbly and pearly, like this little rivulet. In the third verse, the singer sings about the mill wheels turning and sending the water splashing on in their merry dance. And here, as we play, we think of the mill wheels turning. Why, says the singer, even the heavy millstones with their dull white faces seem to reflect the dancing spirit of the waters. And here, as we play, we think of the heavy millstones. And in the fifth and last verse, the singer once again goes back and rhapsodizes on the idea, the joy of roaming. Sometimes the composer of a strophic song slightly varies the vocal line, slightly varies the accompaniment to fit in with the characters of his story. And Brahms does this in one of his most charming songs. It's called Vergebliches Ständchen, The Vain Serenade. The scene of this song is a little tiny village of 20 or 30 thatched roofed cottages miles from anywhere. It's bitterly cold, and when this song starts, it's dreadfully late at night. Everybody in the village has been in bed and asleep for a couple of hours at least. It's about 10:05, you know. When suddenly the silence of the night is rather rudely disturbed by a young farmer coming back from his work. I don't know where he's been since he stopped work, but he's on his way home at last. I think he's rolling slightly when he suddenly realizes he's passing the house of his sweetheart. And without a moment's hesitation, he lets out a yell. And he calls up to her window, good evening, darling. Wake up, get out of bed, come down and open your door to me. I want to kiss you good night. Well, I have no singer here with me, but I'm sure you'll find that the piano part does tell the story. It gives you the character of this chap. It's truly rural. And you can almost hear him saying, Let me in. Let me in. The girl very quickly springs out of bed. She's been in bed a couple of hours. I told you it's 10:05. She rushes to her window and she opens it. And she looks down on this fellow down there and she says, "How dare you come here at this time of the night? Be off with you. I shall most certainly not open my door to you tonight. And let me tell you, if I have any further trouble, I shall refer the matter to Mother." And now, although you can hear that the accompaniment remains substantially the same, Brahms does something to it. He takes away the masculinity and the roughness, and it now becomes feminine and dainty as the girl talks. Well, of course, the young fellow can see he's getting nowhere with his bullying and his blustering. So he changes his tactics. He starts to plead. "Oh," he says, "oh, please let me in for a moment, because I'm absolutely perished with cold down here, and the wind is coming down the street, and it's going right through me." And here in this verse, you can hear the wind howling, and you can almost feel this fellow shivering with the cold. Well, of course, what happens is that the young girl starts to laugh at him. After all, she can afford to laugh because she's upstairs in the warm and he's downstairs in the cold. And she says to him, "Look here, if your love isn't strong enough to stand a little cold, it's no use to me. So be off with you, and good night, my boy." But as she ticks him off, you can hear her in the piano part laughing, tittering with laughter all through this verse. Just listen to this tittering effect in the piano part. Well, that's the end of the song, so far as the singer is concerned, but it's not the end of the story. The accompaniment goes on and finishes the story for you, and you'll know exactly what's happening in the next moment, because you'll hear this young lady closing her window with a most decided bang. While the chap in the street, what is he doing? He says to himself, "Well, I'm damned." I think perhaps at this juncture, I ought to explain that over and above these accompaniments I've been playing to you, there's a very nice tune going on in the voice part, which is most important, or quite important anyway. You know, it reminds me of the old story of two double bass players who were down in the orchestra pit of a small opera house. As they soared away, they looked as if they were in a crowded subway, strap hanging. Of course, they hadn't any idea what was happening on the stage. After all, they were miles down there, and the opera had only been running for about 3 months. Anyway, this is the sort of thing they did night after night. Night after night, they did that. One evening, one of these double bass players said to his friend, "It's my night off tomorrow night. Do you know what I'm going to do?" His friend said, "No." "I'm coming to see the show. I'm coming to see the opera." His friend said, "You're not." And he said, yes, I am. And he did. He rejoined his friend a night later. Do you know, he said, there are some marvellous tunes in this show going on the stage while we're playing down here? His friend said, there aren't. Yes, there are, he said. You know this tune we play? Yes, I know it by heart. Well, the other chap said, there's a wonderful tune going on the stage while we're playing that. This is what it is. So, as I say, you mustn't forget there are some wonderful tunes going on in the voice part above my accompaniment. So far, I've shown you the accompaniment painting pictures and helping the singer to tell the story. The other subject I mentioned earlier was that great responsibility, that wonderful task that the accompanist has of evoking a mood, creating an atmosphere. Sometimes in our introductions to these lovely songs, we find we have ample space, plenty of time in which to express ourselves and in which to transmit the mood to the listener. But I want to show you, first, a song by Schubert called Wanderer's Nachtlied, Wanderer's Night Song. The singer says, the whole landscape is still. Not a sound is heard, even the birds are quiet. Have patience, my soul, only wait, and one day you too will find such peace. You can say that the spirit of this song is one of religious tranquility, but the accompanist has only a short introduction, just a few chords taking a few seconds to play, in which to let you know that the mood is to be one of religious tranquility. The introduction being so short, it means the accompanist must be right in the mood before he starts to play. He mustn't gradually feel his way into it. The exact tempo, the exact color must be in his mind before his fingers touch the notes. It sounds awfully simple, this little introduction, but I'd like to try and play it to you. Of course, any child can sit down and play those chords, but the question is, how do you play them? What is in your mind when you play them? Because, you know, you can't just sit down, raise your hands in the air, let them fall on the keys, and expect a miracle to happen. You've got to think about it. You've got to have the greatest reverence for it. We look in music for curves. We look for a rising curve and a falling curve. This is human nature, after all. When we speak, we start a sentence low down in the voice. Then, as we get towards the middle, our voice rises, like mine is rising now. And as we get to the end of the sentence, our voice just naturally falls. In some pieces of music, this rise and fall is a tremendous arch. But in this particular song, the rise and fall is just a tiny undulation, slightly up and slightly down. So we start at the bottom of this curve and we work up. We increase the tone with each chord. Now we're at the top of the arch. And now we start to work down. Each chord less, less. And that wants a great deal of critical listening. It wants great control of your touch, and also it wants a great deal of love and tremendous respect for what you're playing. I would like to show you very quickly just a few of Schubert's magical strokes of the pen where he is able, apparently without any effort at all, to evoke a mood in the mind of the sensitive listener. There's a song, Tränenregen, Teardrops, which tells us of a young lad's love for a girl, of his hopes of winning her, and of his despair when he finds she loves another. And you know, we often find, if we've studied the words properly, we get a synopsis of the plot or story of the song in our little piano introduction. And in this song, you'll hear hope and despair expressed in these few bars. I'm sure you'll notice where hope ends and where despair creeps in. And then, for a contrast, listen to the anger and the malice in this song called Jealousy and Pride. This is really spiteful. And now, Frühlingstraum, Dream of Spring. This is just innocent and lovely, and Schubert gives you a tiny hint at the end of this introduction, which really tells you that it is springtime. Did you hear that little cuckoo? Mind you, Schubert does not underline that little effect. It's just one of those wonderful and precious jewels you find if love to search for them. Schubert can be very amusing in some of his moods. There's a song of his called Der Einsame, The Lonely One. This tells of a chap who comes back from work and says, "Now I'm home, all I want to do is to get the fire going, put on my carpet slippers, light my pipe, and sit down in my armchair, and I don't give a fig for anyone. I don't want to go out. I don't want to go to the theater. I don't want to go dancing. I don't want to see the girls." What an idiot the man is, isn't he? At all events, he's just smug, very self-satisfied. And I'm sure this accompaniment will convey to you this mood of smugness, this prim bachelor's self-sufficiency. Of course, this little figure in the bass here, that's where he's snuggling back in his armchair. There's a great song of Schubert's that I would like to talk about for a few minutes, and that is Erl König, the Erl King. If this song is well sung and well played, the terror of it will grip the listener by the throat. It tells of the father on his galloping horse, charging madly through the forest at dead of night, with his dying boy clasped in his arms. And the boy, in his fever, in his delirium, fancies he can see the specter of death chasing him down the forest path. Death, of course, being the Erl King. And the father tries to reassure the boy. He says, "My son, what you see there is only a wraith of mist." But he spurs his horse on quicker and quicker until at last he pulls up at his home, only to find that his boy is dead in his arms. Now this song has a most tremendous accompaniment. You hear in my right hand the galloping hooves of the horse right through the song like this. And you hear in my left hand this suggestion of the shudder of the boy as he sees this horrible spectre. I'd like to play a few bars of this accompaniment. And so on it clatters right through this terrifying song. And it's this song which brings to my mind one of the most trying problems with which the accompanist has to cope. The problem of balance, the balance of tone between the voice of the singer and the voice of the piano. Because, you see, that accompaniment is terribly difficult to play. And when I was a youngster and came across this song for the first time, I was frightened to death by the technical difficulty of it, and I seized the opportunity of going to hear a famous pianist who is going to accompany a singer in this very song. I went to the concert and sat there with a splendid view of the keyboard to try to find out how this great man managed this piano part. Well, to cut a long story short, I sat there boggle-eyed with wonder, but for all my binoculars, which were fixed on his fingers, I was unable to find out how he did it. I went home none the wiser. Couldn't sleep for thinking about it. When I suddenly came to in the early hours of the morning and remembered that there had been a singer. Now, the singer was a young fellow, hefty and strong. He had a big voice, too. Working hard, he was. Red in the face, perspiring copiously. But all I could hear of the singer was... In fact, I couldn't hear him at all, you see. He was completely drowned by the pianist. Now, for some reason or other, which I've never been able to explain, singers do object to being drowned. You know, we accompanists, we can't afford to be like the famous conductor who'd been conducting an opera at Covent Garden. At the end of the performance, a friend went into the dressing room to see this great man, and he said to him, "You were simply marvellous tonight. I've never heard the orchestra play so superbly. Why, I've heard this opera some 50 or 60 times during the course of my life, but you did something with the orchestra. You brought out things in the score which I didn't know existed. It was an absolute revelation. It was really marvellous. But," he said, "I must tell you one thing. Couldn't hear the singers at all. You completely drowned them." Sir Thomas replied, "I know, I drowned them intentionally. I drowned them in the interest of the public." Well, we accompanists can't afford to be quite so public-spirited as that. But it's not so easy for us, because the singer stands, as I told you, in the bend of the piano, and directs his or her voice into the auditorium. The singer, therefore, will be standing almost with his back to the accompanist. This means that the audience, certainly the front half of the audience, are going to hear the singer's voice in greater volume than the accompanist. It means that an accompanist has got to use great judgment to assess how much or how little tone. I want to play to you in this connection the accompaniment to Schubert's Die. This is a great hymn of praise to God, and the piano has got to sound like an organ. It's got to give the impression of the great diapason tone of an organ rolling through a cathedral. ¶¶ If I were playing that song for a singer, even a singer with a big, noble voice, I could hardly hear her above the noise I'm making on the piano. With her back to me, all I shall hear from the singer is a wisp of tone. So if anybody was sitting next to me, on my left, turning the pages, he would say to himself, "This fellow is drowning the singer." But if I wanted to hear that singer properly, I should have to play the accompaniment like this. And at once, all the might, all the majesty, all the glory have gone out of the song. And more than that, the singer, whether the singer were a great singer or a less than great singer, would be unable to carry on with such flimsy support as that. She needs tremendous tonal support from the piano in a song of that nature, not only psychologically, but physically. Vocally, she needs a strong foundation of tone on which to lean, to help her through what is a tremendous test of endurance. So you can see how important it is for the accompanist to give all the support he can and yet not to drown the singer's tone. Believe me, it's quite a problem. Mind you, I'm referring now to the concert hall. This has nothing to do with a studio broadcast. In a broadcast, the problem of balance is taken out of your hands. For on the radio, the singer has one microphone and the accompanist another. And there's an expert, at least he says he's an expert, sitting in a little box, twiddling a couple of knobs, and he adjusts the balance according to his taste. Mind you, he may know nothing about music. He's able to raise the singer's volume as much as he likes, and he's able to lower the accompanist's volume almost to nothing. He loves doing that. At the end of your broadcast, you say to this chap, "How was the balance?" And he says, in fact, he admits, "It was perfect." But as I say, on the concert platform, the balance is entirely the accompanist's responsibility when he's with a singer. With a violinist or a cellist, the responsibility is shared, and the string player must be alive to this. I was rehearsing, for instance, the Brahms E minor sonata with a cellist. And there is a section where the cello is accompanying the piano. All the cellist does is this. And the piano plays the tune gently above the cello, like this. It's nice, isn't it? But it's quite spoiled if the cellist is not content to accompany the piano. I have heard the cellist sawing away and quite ruining it in this fashion. Well, cellists are always afraid that they won't be heard. There's another passage in this same Brahms sonata where the piano does this. I was rehearsing this with the cellist, and when we had done that, he stopped playing, and he said, "I say, old man, the cello has a tune there, you know." I replied, "Well, I'm playing very softly. I'm sure your tone comes through all right without any trouble." He said, "Well, you know, you can't play too softly in that part." "All right," I said, "let's try it again. I'll try and play it lighter if I can." So we tried again. Thank you. And so on we went right through the passage. When we'd finished, I said, did you feel more comfortable then? Well, you know, old chap, you really can't possibly play too softly there. Well, I felt a bit mad at this. I clenched my teeth and I said, well, look here, let's try it again. We went right through the passage again, and this time I scarcely touched the notes. And I said, how was that? He said, well, old man, you really can't play too softly there, you know. So far as balance is concerned, I refer to this subject on one occasion in print. I said, no matter how softly we sing or how softly we play, we must make sure our softest tones reach the back of the hall. Not because the music critics are sleeping in the back row, but because if our tone does reach the back of the hall, everybody in the hall will have heard it. And Ernest Newman, the great critic, took me to task over this. He said, Gerald Moore is quite mistaken if he thinks we critics are sleeping in the back row. I would like to assure Mr. Moore that I've tried hard for years to get to sleep during concerts, but I've failed miserably. But I think I must tell you of an experience I had when the whole problem of balance was summed up for me in a most wonderful way. This was the first time I'd ever been engaged to play at an important concert, and also the first time I'd ever played for a really famous singer. I was very young, very nervous, and very inexperienced. And this prima donna was a terrifying woman. She was tall and stately, like Tennyson's Maud. But unlike Tennyson's Maud, she was more, a great deal more, than 17. 17 stone, perhaps. A 240-pounder, if you like. But at all events, she was terrifying. She wore a glittering tiara. She had a long train. In fact, she had everything, and literally everything, that goes with a great prima donna. She took up her stand in the bend of the piano, and I waited for her to give me the signal to start the introduction to the first song. After what seemed an eternity, she swung her regal torso in my direction and gave me a frigid nod. And I was just going to begin when she suddenly leaned across the piano and she hissed at me, "Not too loud!" Well, you know, that rather shook me. I didn't know artists talked on the platform like that. I have since found out differently. But as I say, it shook me. So I said to myself, keep calm, take your time, don't get flustered. Everything will be all right if you don't worry. Just take it easy. You see, I was just having a private tussle with myself. And I suppose she wondered what was going on, because I saw her out of the corner of my eye making impatient signs for me to start again. And once again, I prepared to start. See, I hadn't played a note yet, you see. But she was at me again, and this time she hissed, but not too soft. Well, do you know, for a long time, I hated that poor lady. But now that I've got a little older, I look back on that experience with gratitude, because it really was a masterly summing up of the way to obtain a perfect balance. There it is in a nutshell. Not too loud and not too soft. Another problem that comes the way of the accompanist is something called transposition. Now, some of you might not know exactly what transposition is, but you will when I finish with you, I can assure you. First of all, transposition is this. The accompanist sees a piece of music in front of him in one key, and he plays it in another. Intentionally, of course, intentionally. For argument's sake, suppose the music in front of me were All the Lads, They Smile at Me When Coming Through the Rye. We'll say it's in the key of C major. Perhaps I'm asked to transpose it from C major to F sharp major. I still see it on the page in C major because the printed notes don't change. I have to change these notes in my head. so that instead of having this... we have this. And if you think that coming through the Rye from C major to F sharp major, if you think that emerging from the Rye that all the lads are still smiling, you're vastly mistaken. What happens, to put it bluntly, is this. The accompanist's eyes register the key of C major, but in his brain the notes are changed, and by some magic on the accompanist's part, the music comes out in a different key. Well, I don't want to go into the difficulties involved in transposing. I want to show you how transposing affects the listener without his being aware of it. There's a song by Schubert called Im Frühling, In the Springtime. In one section of this song, the piano gives you a delicious effect of a little rippling stream, birds twittering, buds gleaming in the sunshine. Here it is, in the original key of G. A lovely tinkling sound, full of sunshine and brightness. Sometimes, the singer will say, I find that key too high. Will you please play it a tone down in F? And I want you to notice a very subtle change in the quality of sound when the song is taken from here and played here. There's a slight difference, you know. A little of the brightness and buoyancy has gone out of the music. But when you transpose it even further away from Schubert's original key, this difference in the quality of sound becomes more obvious. There's very little glow left. A year or two ago, I had to play this song down a fourth. Instead of in G, I had to play it in D. And this is what it sounded like. Now, it's become heavy and dull and grey. The brightness and the sheen have gone from it, and that is how, unsuspectingly, the listener is affected by transposition. Because you may go to a concert where this lovely song is on the programme, and perhaps you play it yourself, or perhaps a friend plays it, and you say, what a delicious song, how nice it'll be to hear that song this evening. And you go to the concert. But perhaps Im Frühling is being sung in a transposed key, and you're disappointed, and you don't know why. It doesn't occur to you, and why should it, that the song has been transposed. All you say to yourself is, well, I'm not so thrilled with that song and its lovely accompaniment as I expect it to be. I don't think Moore is as good as I thought he was. He's certainly not as good as he thinks he is. Well, this is one of the burdens the accompanist has to bear without advertisement and without complaint. He can't stand up and explain to the audience that he's playing the song in a transposed key. But it's not only transposing down that can upset the song. Transposing up can have its disadvantages too. Take a song that is full of muscle and masculinity, like Brahms's Der Schmied, the blacksmith. Now, this is a weighty affair. This is how it goes. Der Schmied is transposed up. This is the effect you get. Well, at once you can see that the blacksmith has turned into a tinsmith. Anyway, these are instances where the listener's enjoyment is affected by transposition. Talking of transposing, I must tell you of an actual experience of mine. A bass singer came to rehearse with me. He could only speak a few words of English. We got on splendidly. One of the songs he had on his program was Der Einsame, the lonely one, the song which I spoke about earlier, you know, the smug man, the abominable smug man. Anyway, we went right through the song in the original key of F. Evidently, he found that key a little bit uncomfortable because he turned to me and said, "Is too high." I said, "Is too high?" He said, "Is too high." You see, the conversation was becoming quite animated. "Well," I said, "I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put it down half a tone. Instead of having it in F, we'll have it in E. Instead of here, we'll have it here." We went right through it again. This time he turned to me and he said, "Is too low." I said, "Is too low?" You see, I was beginning to cotton on to the language myself by this time. He said, "Is too low." "Well," I said, "I don't know what the dickens I can do about it." And I showed him with my finger. I first of all played it in this key in F. Then I played it in this key, E. And he looked at these two notes for a long time. And then he said, "Have you nothing in between?" Well, I don't know whether he expected me to play on the cracks or not, I'm sure. Perhaps he expected me to do this. I hope that what I've said and played has convinced you that the field of the accompanist is wonderfully interesting and varied. Take my advice. When a song is being performed, open your ears and your minds impartially to what the singer and the accompanist are saying to you.